that there will be lunch downstairs in the common room after this talk. Our next talk of the morning and final talk of the morning will be Matthew Durham, who will be speaking on geometrical finiteness in beach subgroups of mapping classrooms.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation to speak. It's good to see a lot of friends and colleagues, and have a really great group of good talks. So let me just say, it's hard to follow Autumn. I will not be telling too many jokes. But I piggyback on that too. All right. So I want to talk about geometric finiteness, which should be some generalization of convex compactness. I spent some time talking about convex compactness in a slightly different way than she did. But in our back of our minds, we're always still thinking about surface moments. So recall, for an exact sequence, an exact sequence to determine. Oh, I should set up some notation. So S is always going to be a closed, orientable surface of finite type. And I want the genus to be bigger than equal to 2. So if I want to add a puncture, then I'll this would be S of a puncture or a mark point. Mapping class group. So I don't work with Juan Soto, so this will be the mapping class group. And the space, I'll just put on the type. And the curve graph, which we've heard a lot about. I see this. All right, so it's just nice sort of bundle for mapping class groups. If I take a mapping class, clearly I'm not giving myself enough space for this. <Is that okay>? So if I take a mapping class, serve the puncture, then I can just forget about the puncture. And this gives me now a mapping class on serve without the puncture. What happens with this puncture when I forget? So I'm saying I'm taking a homeomorphism with surface where I'm fixing the puncture, and then forgetting about the puncture, I'm getting some different class. So if I get some different homeomorphism, then really this is differing by the original homeomorphism I started with by some isotopy. So I can look at the puncture, follow the puncture around this isotopy. And that gives me some elements of the fundamental proof of the surface. Berman proved that this was precisely the kernel of that map. If I take a subgroup, a mapping class, then under this projection, I can pull back to some subgroup here, and this will give me some surface group extension that I'll denote by gamma g. And once again, in the kernel, so let me start with just kind of a big question. So what conditions on our chosen subgroup G, the mapping class group alpha puncture, so lead to kind of hyperbolic, or parenthetically, geometric conclusions. About the extension group. And an Autumn stuff we already saw, I don't know if she actually said this explicitly. We already saw that we have a complete answer when we want to conclude that the extension group is hyperbolic. So this is sort of a theorem definition of convex compactness. And so this theory was first originally developed by Farb and Mosher, further developed by Hammerstadt, and then this and then this really beautiful paper from Lanier, which they really develop the Kirk complex perspective. G, not the class group. It's called convex compact. If any of the following equivalent conditions holds, it's not an acronym, but. Right. So, the first one that you've already seen is that you can orbit of the group into the curve graph. And this is a quasi-isometric embed. So this is not the original definition, and I'll write that down in a second. But from this we can automatically see, particularly to that, that G is a hyperbolic group. So we're quasi-isometrically embedding into this Gromov hyperbolic space, which is hyperbolic by Theorem of Mason-Rominsky. So we automatically get that G is a hyperbolic group. So this basis was originally, Amenstadt and Kent Leininger both developed this, this particular characterization. Here's the original definition. So I can also think about the mapping class group acting on Teichmuller space with the Teichmuller metric, or any metric, but particularly the Teichmuller metric here. And if it's orbit into the Teichmuller space, then we want to say this is quasi-convex. So this is the original definition of Farben-Mosher, and maybe in a minute I'll kind of give some thoughts on this. So through Adam's talk, and kind of building on what Jason was saying yesterday, so we can think about the mapping class group as being built from all these curve graphs, and kind of sitting at the top is a curve graph of the whole surface. And what she was saying is that sometimes you look at the image of a group inside, sometimes you actually have to look what happens down inside of other curved graphs. And if that happens, and somehow the situation is a little more complicated, but for these convex co-compact groups, what we see is we see the geometry faithfully represented inside of the curved graph. And there's this kind of long-standing analogy with kind of tons of evidence that I was thinking about the thick part of the Teichmuller space as being kind of the hyperbolic part of the mapping class group. And that thick part, of the uniformly thick part of the Teichmuller space somehow is encoded inside of this curved graph as well. And what does a quasi-convex orbit mean? Well, it means that the orbit itself is going to live in some thick part, hitting a marked surface with mapping of an element of the mapping class group doesn't change any kind of the total, all the lengths of curves on the surface. So it's not going to somehow make a marking a curve, the shortest curve on a surface shorter. But quasi-convexity then says that the Teichmuller geodesics between any points in the orbit actually have to stay close to the orbit and thus have to stay in the thick part as well. And so let me come back to that in a minute. So the last characterization, or the next characterization we'll talk about, is thinking about inside the mapping class group. And what I want is I want the orbit map to be, it's called a stable embedding. And so this is the characterization we do to Sam Taylor and myself. And the idea here is we saw this actually in Kasra's talk, so the first talk from Monday. So I'm not going to give you the proper definition of this, but you can think about this as being undistorted. And maybe I'll say uniformly contracting, because that was what he was talking about. So we have this, he was thinking about looking at particular word maps and mapping class, word metrics and mapping class group, and looking at the axis of the pseudo-Nosov and asking whether or not if you take a ball that's disjoint from, of any size that's disjoint from this axis and looking down at some projection, perhaps the closest point projection, or whether or not that ball is uniformly bounded size set. And so we don't quite have, there was this weaker notion where if you take a ball that's slightly more removed from your G, geodesics, so some proportion of the radius or some proportion of the radius and proportion of the distance from the geodesic, then you want to have a uniform projection, and that's what you can take this to mean, is that kind of any ball that's disjoint, proportional to the radius proportional for the distance to the set, to the orbit here, then that ball projects to some bounded diameter set. And what you think about that meaning is that somehow the image of this group lies in the hyperbolic part, purely hyperbolic part of the mapping class group. So we saw from Autumn, so this theorem of Vespino, Bromberg, Kempe, Lanier, is that G is distorted and purely Pseudo-Manasov. And maybe one thing I'll say about this is that every Pseudo-Manasov has a contraction, has some sort of contraction property. And you might just, what this says is that, well, it's enough just to know that every element has a contraction property, and there's a uniform contraction for free group. Okay, so what does this have to do with surface group extensions? So the last property, Matty's here, is that G, the surface group extension, is hyperbolic. So by here, I just mean throw off there. Okay. So my goal for today's talk is to have some sort of broad conversation about trying to generalize this sort of picture. What we're really interested in, so I have my vague question from the beginning, says, what conditions can I put on a group to lead that give me some sort of hyperbolic conclusions about the geometry of the extension group? So in the case we want to know that the extension group is purely hyperbolic, we have a bunch of different characterizations. And I should say that there are other characterizations in terms of, say, looking at the limit set and Thurston's compactification of Teichmuller space and taking a weak hull of that and acting hull, and that gives you this sort of convex compactness name, which is motivated by the original Kleinian setting. And maybe some notion of geometrical finiteness, which is kind of the point of this talk, should be motivated from the original Kleinian setting, but for our purposes today, what I really want to think about is, when can I say something about the geometry of the extension group? So I'm not going to give you a definition of what geometric finiteness, maybe I'll write down some things that could be that. But I want to start with some question of Mosher, which is that, is there a good definition of this? Definition on geometric finiteness. So, whatever this should mean, if we want to say something reasonable about the geometry of the group, of the extension group, we're probably going to want that the group to be undistorted in the mapping class group. So group G should probably be undistorted in the mapping class group. And then, we know that if it's pseudo all the elements are pseudo Nasov, then we already know it's convex group of that. So if we want to be able to say something reasonable, then we probably want that our group is undistorted in the group. And then we have some elements that aren't pseudo Nasov. So before I say more about that, what do we actually want from a good definition? So we have a bunch of characterizations, and I've left off several. And we don't necessarily need all of them, but we have our favorite objects, the curve graph in Teichmuller space, and Kähler graph or the Martian graph for the mapping class group. So we want some robust characterizations. For any such definition. We want hyperbolic information. About this extension, that's kind of the whole point of this. And then, so what's the point of a definition without any examples? the rest of the talk, we'll be talking about some specific examples, and then we want kind of checkable conditions. The definition on the key examples. So let's talk about one of the key examples. And those are beech trees. So what I want to do now is I want to give kind of a mid-level picture of what a beech group is. I'll just tell you kind of the basics of what I need in terms of geometry of how it lives inside of Teichmuller space and how it interacts with the mapping class group, so that we can keep it in kind of this hazy framework of developing a definition. Okay. So maybe I'll also just say that I'm also going to talk about, I mentioned some combination groups of these beech groups. So these are called binding or reed. And the point about both of these, maybe I'll go back to Autumn's talk. So these are going to be fundamental groups of punctured surfaces, and these are going to be fundamental groups of, and sometimes they're fundamental groups of closed surfaces that have nice properties. And so we can think about every time we take a bundle over one of these things, it's going to be the fundamental group of some four-manifold. So in some sense, whatever conclusions we want to make at the end, we'll be talking about the geometry of the fundamental group of some four-manifold, and in this case, some closed four-manifold. Right, so the first thing I have to tell you is what a Teichmuller disk is. Isometrically embedded, totally geodesic copy of H2 and sitting inside of Teichmuller space. There are a bunch of these things. My point is, there are many different ones sitting there. Okay, so what's a beech group? So for our purposes today, a subgroup G of the mapping class group. Oh, sorry, of a stabilizer. So I have this isometrically embedded copy of H2 sitting inside of the Teichmuller space, the mapping class group acts by isometries. I can look at its stabilizer. This gives me some action of some group isometries on H2. So if you look, I want to take a subgroup, the group of isometries. So let's call this D. So Teichmuller just D. D will stay that for the rest of the talk. It's called lattice of each group. The quotient, so I have this disk and I have this hyperbolic plane, I can take the quotient by the action, and I just want to require that this be a finite following hyperbolic surface. So this will always have punctures. And so we just have some group acting by isometries on H2, I guess a homomorphism in SL2R, and I just want to equivalent to saying that the image of this homomorphism of G into SL2R is a lattice. We can just take the big one, that's fine. We can just take the stable issue, that's fine. Yeah. I mean, for this stuff, that's fine. So there are different ways to see this, but one way to see this is we have the beech dichotomy. Is that So if we look at the action of D on the boundary of D, which is just homeomorphic to the circle, so the boundary of HQ, sitting inside of PML, so Thurston's compactification of Teichmuller space. Let me draw a picture. We have our disk D sitting inside the Teichmuller space. And we take for each of these parabolic fixed points, we can take some hyperbolic. And then we can look at a G-equivariate collection of these guys. We'll take a separated collection of them. Points. Parabolic fixed points. And what's really happening here is I have some multi-curve here, and I think I'm taking the points on the boundary in some sense towards this parabolic fixed point. I'm really just pinching down this multi-curve, so I'm making all these curves shorter, and the different Bohr cycles I get are level sets of those length functions on the surface. So there are two different objects I want to think about here. One, so there's two standard things you do with a relatively hyperbolic group. I have this object, and I have these kind of geometric subspaces that are all separated from each other. And one thing you do, say the setting is you excise the hyperbolics. And that's what I'll call B. So I'm just thinking about taking all these hyperbolics again. And I really should be drawing a fairly many, but I don't have the time. and I'm just cutting these out. Pardon?
Draw faster.
Flame moving measures. And I'm cutting them out. And this will actually be quasi-isometric to the group. So the group is X. The group will act properly and co-compactly. So if you're not familiar with what the relatively hyperbolic group is, what it is, it's a group, and it has a bunch of subgroups. Then you take some finite collection of subgroups, and you look at an equivariant collection of its cosets. And what you do is one definition, which is my favorite definition, apologies to Brian, is you take a hyperbolic and you just stick it on top of the subgroup, and that gives you some hyperbolic space. And in this context, we get H2. And so that's one definition. So the other space that I'm going to think about is I'll denote D hat. And this is what I'm gonna, what I'll do here is I'll take my collection of four balls. And I'll just cone them off. So I'll add a point, an abstract point, over each four ball, and just make them all have diameter one. I'm running out of patience for this. But I also have, I have to complete it. Okay, so another definition, which I don't have time to explain, is that you have some collection of subsets, you collapse all of them into points, and then you have to have some properties about how the geodesics interact with these subspaces. And that's kind of the original definition of the part. So this is the Kondov. Think about this, the Kondov Haley graph. G. Okay. Okay, so maybe make a couple of remarks. One, so G is not, so there are several ways to see that these feature groups are not convex but compact. Just from our going back to our original definitions, so one, or this original theorem, so it has multi-twists, so these are not pseudo-Nosov, so by this last characterization, or even more elementary considerations, it's not pseudo-Nosov, but thinking about it in terms of what's happening with the Teichmuller metric as well, so here's my group. I think about excising the Hoare balls, and what does the Teichmuller geodesic do? Teichmuller geodesic that's going between two different points on one of these Hoare cycles is that it goes deep inside. Twisting is easy when the curve is short. So you move deep in, can't really see that, you go deep inside the Hoare ball where twisting is cheap. And that's going to get arbitrarily far away from the orbit of the group. But so in particular, it's not quasi-convex. The orbit's not quasi-convex. Okay. So these objects are really nice. So in a little bit, I'll just tell you that but how you actually get one of these things is even nicer than it looks. So let me tell you, just state a theorem. I'm not going to tell you what these line degree subgroups are, but the point is that they're built. Sorry. That was a bad choice. On my part. I don't remember the notation that's gone. Okay. So, here's the theorem of line degree. What it says is that when you find two closed surfaces of the closed oriented global finite type, but particular for us, closed. Is that you get an injection of the fundamental group of one into the other, into the mapping class group of the other. Okay, so there are lots of those. What do I care? For all but one conjugacy constant element, pseudo-Nosov. So it's as close in some sense. This can be to having a purely a pseudo-Nosov surface subgroup that we have. Right. So what I'll say is that I'm not gonna give a definition of this even later, but the idea is that these are built as combinations. Setting of each groups. And thus, kind of, you can set arguments that apply to each groups apply to these in some sense. Maybe with some, definitely with some extra thought. But, which of arguments for each groups can often extend to these. I'm going to keep this board. Because now I want to, now I want to talk about, when did I start? 120? Oh, 15? Okay, so maybe some geometric finiteness properties. Of these lattice speech groups. And in many cases, these linear recombination groups. So the first one, which I will attribute to Tango Web, is worth understanding what the image of these Tychmoor discs in various ways inside of the curve graph, the nice geometric properties they have. So what we can do is we can take the systole map. So I just want to think I have a map from Tychmoor space to the curve graph, and I just, because I have a, well, there are different notions of length on the surface, but in particular I could just take the hyperbolic metric on the surface and then take the shortest curve, and this gives me some disjoint collection of curves on the surface. What it proved is that the systole map restricts to the quasi-isometric embedding of this coned off Cayley graph, this electrified Tychmoor disk into the curve. So, I have a question. Is systole endpoint is pi on the thin? No. You know, it was just asked what curves, what sort of curves do you have. But they're not disjoint, right? Oh, yeah. Right. So, great. You get this disjoint simplex when it's short. Yeah, because you don't have the call. but it's always, as you found it. Oh, it is okay. So, you do get some more. Everything's coarse. Right, so what was I saying? So we have this is the coned off Cayley graph. So think about this electrified Tychmoor disk. This is the coned off Cayley graph of our beach group. And saying that a QI embeds into the curve graph is kind of a relative version of saying that the orbit map for a convex with a compact subgroup is quasi convex in the curve graph. So this is with Spencer and Chris and Alex Sisto. So this is a, we don't want different space. Okay, I'm gonna give myself different space. So I'm gonna draw some pictures. We have some property that's reminiscent of the first property for convex compactness that I wrote down, at least the curve graph property. So maybe we want one for Tychmoor space.
No. Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So in the Tang Web theorem, is it really necessary that you have a lattice at some? Like your Tychmoor disk is. So like omega is a lattice, or does it?
I need this peripheral structure.
You need the okay.
Yeah. So I'm collapsing some parts.
No, but
of
if
this.
You just had like a surface where you know you have some kind of weak dichotomy, is that enough without being a lattice? Like you had either you need to be according for totally periodic directions without the symmetric group being a lattice, is that?
So the geometric arguments that I know they can like take what they've done and turn this into this statement. I don't know how to do it.
Like if you just took the Tychmoor disk and electrified it, would it still work? Anyway, never mind.
I don't know. Yeah. Okay, we talked about this after. Okay. Okay, so maybe something So the idea about the property I want to write down now is something about having a quasi-convex orbit in something like type Lorentz space. But just as with the curve graph statement, we need to collapse some pieces because these parabolic elements, these multi-twists, they cause trouble. So instead of collapsing parts of the disk itself, I want to collapse part of type Lorentz space, but not all type Lorentz space. So maybe I'll recall the theorem of Mazur-Minsky that if I take a Teichmuller space and I collapse all the thin parts, it's called the electric Teichmuller space, and this is quasi-asymmetric to the curve graph. So if I collapse all the thin regions, all these places where I have all the product regions that I have, I get back this hyperbolic object. And I want to do something less violent than this. Ayers, not that way. So what I want to do is, I said, I want to collapse the thin parts corresponding to these multi-twists in their translates. So let this Teichmuller space of a half do the partial collapse. Partial electrification, I'll say. Partial electrification. A type obtained by collapsing the thin parts corresponding to these to the alpha I and their G translates. So I take an equivariant collection of thin parts and collapse them. In the picture is, I have my Teichmuller space, it's a ball. I have this disk that's kind of cutting through it. Gives me a circle on the boundary versus classification. I have all these, I'm just drawing a horizontal picture of this, this horizontal picture of this Teichmuller space outside. And what I want to do is, I want to take the entire thin part lying over each of this, over this equivariant collection of these four balls. And I want to collapse it down. And the statement is that the orbit map from my group into this flat Teichmuller space is quasi-convex. Somehow collapsing down all these thin parts ruins all the obstructions you need to kind of live in the thick part of Teichmuller space. So in this relative Teichmuller space, you get a quasi-convex image. So how do you actually know what a geodesic looks like down there? Well, you don't. But what you do know is, you can use some of this hyperbolic machinery to prove this statement, but what you actually know is that the orbit has a stable image. Has this uniformly contracting image. In the sense that Hauser was talking about, when it's stable. And what this means in particular, just means that not only can quasi-geodesics kind of escape the subset if they're going to move between points in the subsets, but geodesic in particular can't do that. So maybe let me say, I don't know how to add. That means I end at 5 after, sorry. Let me say two words about what a general definition of this might mean, or geometrical finite this might mean. So you should have some group that sits nicely inside your mapping class group. Inevitably, it should be undistorted. You should have some parabolic collection, some collection of subgroups that you sort of are parabolic. Maybe they're just they all sit inside of some stabilizer or some curve. You should have, and then maybe this is the right definition. You want to be able to collapse down these parabolic or collapse down. So this is the coned off Cayley graph. We can just cone off that Cayley graph. It'll be relatively hyperbolic to those parabolic subgroups. You collapse those parabolic subgroups, and then you get a QI embedding into the curve graph. And then in that context, I'm fairly certain that this second property is equivalent to that as well. So the last thing, and the thing I guess I'll spend the rest of the time talking about in less detail than I wanted, is property 5 there. So money. One more time. Okay. So I'm going to talk about these Lanigerie subgroups in a minute, but the point is that they're closed surface subgroups of mapping class groups that have where everything's almost everything is pseudo on itself. So here's the kind of the main point. We've been talking about surface group extensions. So here's the theorem that we have. Right at the moment, there's a partial collapse, which is different, very much different than the one I described before. Gamma G to some space, metric space you build, satisfying the following properties. One, this guy's hyperbolic, so that's great. So the action of gamma G on hat is co-bounded. So it's worth noting that this gamma G always acts on the curve graph of the punctured surface, and in this case that's not going to be the case if you just act on the punctured surface. And what's more, things that should act loxodromically, should act hyperbolically on this hyperbolic space do. Let me just give an example here. So if gamma, so you would expect if I have, so you remember that we have this Schrödinger's X sequence. And so we always have these copies of, we always have this copy of this point pushing subgroup sitting inside of this extension group. And so if I take a filling curve, you would expect it to act hyperbolically. It does. So we look at this subgroup generated by this acting on this graph. It acts loxodromically. But other things happen. So some things that don't act loxodromically, so this would also, of course, happen on the curve graph of the punctured surface, but some things that don't act loxodromically on the curve graph of the punctured surface do here. So if alpha, so theta is some curve on our surface, and it fills with this multi-curve, so i.e. Theta union alpha I is a multi-curve, cuts S into disks. Then its image, beta's image, thinking about it now as an element inside of this point pushing subgroup, beta acts on our graph. So what's worth noting is that as a map element of the mapping class group of the punctured surface, this is a multi-twist. This gives you a multi-twist. So in particular, on the curve graph, it just stabilizes a point, fixes a point. Right. So the last bit, I should say that this theorem right now is just for the Beach group. We don't know exactly how to do this for the Lanigerie combination groups. But we expect that we can. Hopeful. Okay. So, and our conjecture is that gamma G is a hierarchically hyperbolic group in the sense that Jason was talking about. So let me just say two words. So so with Jason the other day, or yesterday, whatever it was, that there's always this top-level curve graph sitting inside of this. You have this collection of domains, and you always have some top-level domain, and there's always this curve graph of this domain. And within our structure, this graph is going to be that graph. And that space is going to be that. Okay. 4 minutes. you blame the organizers? Just myself. All right, so let me. This last part will be for the experts. Okay, so I want to give some description. I want to shoot towards at least describing this object, and then maybe hopefully get to say what this is, but I don't expect it will. So I'll just stop whenever I'm done. I'll stop whenever that's at the time. All right, so fix quadratic non-zero homomorphic quadratic differential. Gives me a V-surface. And so I want to take a Teichler disk, and that just comes from deforming, say, pick your favorite Riemann surface, and deforming this, it just comes from affine deformations of this quadratic differential metric that you get on the surface. So if I have not enough space on the board, I should just erase that. I always have. As with this Riemann exact sequence, we also have a Baer's vibration. So this, I want to think about this as being my Teichmuller disk. This is sitting inside a Teichmuller space. And there's this vibration of Teichmuller space over puncture Teichmuller space. And the fibers are hyperbolic planes. Or we can think about them, in our case, we want to think about them as universal covers of the surface. So over this surface group, we can pull back under this vibration, and we get some bundle, some hyperbolic plane bundle called V. So over each point, we have a copy of the universal cover. So this is just, we'll call this an X, but this is really this topologically universal cover. What I want to do is I want to take this flat metric here, and I want to lift this flat metric up here. So I'll just denote that by drawing a cartoon of the saddle connections you get from the structure. Now if I take 2 points, I get the same thing. And the key point is that the Teichmuller map, from x to y, here's deforming the flat structure on the surface. Yeah, affine deformations. So this is just the identity map topologically. So this lifts to the universal cover, and it lifts to a very nice map. So you know the Teichmuller map by fxy. And this lifts to a nice map between these two fibers. In particular, if I fix a point here on the surface on this fiber, its image, the map restricted to this point, is just going to be the Teichmuller map upstairs as well. Right. So what I want to do, make an observation, is that I can define. I'm not done yet. I want to make a map from the total bundle down to maybe my favorite fiber. And what I want to do is I want to send the fiber over some point. I just want to send it to this lift of this map, x. If I take a pre-image at some point, so if I take some point, say in my e sub x, the pre-image, this is actually going to be the unique Teichmuller disk through this point. So if this is my z here, it's going to be the unique Teichmuller disk on dz through this point in the Teichmuller space of the puncture surface, which projects down to d. So this is always going to be some Teichmuller disk, some copy of h2. So you put up the metric on this bundle. Stop when I finish writing the sentence. It is the orthogonal metric. vertical fibers, these are these new covers, so I'm going to take flat metric, the lifted flat metric, and then on the horizontal fibers, I want to take the Poincaré metric on these copies of these two. And then the point is that the group it's an action, the gamma G emits an action on E, and it's proper and co-compact. So this gives us a model, geometric model for this case. I should stop.
Okay, let's see.